Well, let's move. We are doing a little bit about mobility. I also thank you very much, and I congratulate Kessler and the other department to maintain the line in this cooperation. I am Jesus, we are almost a kid like you when we are starting this cooperation with and have to business and so. And I think it's quite interesting. We are facing some challenges that are similar, but you multiply by 10 when you go to the problems are much bigger. But the fundamentals are almost the same. I organized my. I organized that in a few. Aspects, but it's about how we can do it with the problem that we are facing with mobility today, and then a few experience that we have developed in Lisbon, and I work 4 years there as a councillor and deputy mayor in charge of mobility in Lisbon, and then I stay 4 more years as municipal deputy. We have a local policy in our municipalities that I thank you. So some aspects that we have tried to do and we presented in here. Well, that is the main. We are always facing the same things, that we are. Mobility is growing every time. Even with the crisis, it slows a little bit in Europe, but it's growing again. Public transport is losing market, and people are moving more and more by cars. That makes some problems, not only because of the emissions, but problems of space, problems of congestion, problems of management of the city, or space use. And as George has just come to say to you, our lives today are much more dispersed in terms of space. We are living, maybe we can live in one place, but where we work and where we go for leisure, for friends, etc., it's very diverse. And of course that obliges us to move much more to different points of the metropolitan area than before. And the trips are much more complex. We are not going anymore with like the golden pendulum. Home, work, health, study, work. No more like that. We chain trips from one place to another. The problem is that historically we have to make a very strong connection between economic growth and mobility and transportation. And of course we cannot continue like that. So the big challenge that we are facing now is how to continue to improve economic growth and welfare, but at the same time cut in terms of the trips, in terms of mobility. So we are moving from the concept of mobility to the concept of accessibility. The important thing is to accede to goods, to service, to people. And mobility is just one way to accede to these kind of things. And this is a change of paradigm that is not easy to change. And not easy to change because of these, I think. This is the mainstream that we are facing today. So we are producing about 100 million vehicles per year, but the factories have capacity for 130 million vehicles per year. So they are under capacity now. So if we think that we can just say, bye-bye car, there is no more cars in the future, you are mad at your mind. Because it's not that bad. Cars will be different. They will become much more personalized, much more shared, But the kind of individual mobility is still going on very much. It's not possible to imagine a future society without that, only because of cultural, social, and economic reasons. So it's better to discuss more how we use it in a more rational way than just to think that we can abolish it. Secondly, is the technological evolution. It's incredible. We are now talking about self-driving cars. So I'm here, and then when I finish this day, I want to go to Galata Tower, and I have an application in my mobile phone, and a car stops here in Massimo University and brings me there. I don't even need to know what is the route. He knows already. So everything is going on that way. We can, the richest man in the world, the guy of Amazon now, is promoting a kind of delivery system by drones, so they don't congest things and they drop your merchandise where you want at the time you want. So everything is changing very much, and that means that the access to the means of transport is also very easy. When I was a kid, I remember that in my neighborhood, it was quite a healthy neighborhood in any case, that we organized each other to go by car to the beaches. The best beaches, not the beaches, they very close to the city, because there are a lot of people, so the people that have cars, so we go further on to have beaches with less people, less polluting. But even there, we organize ourselves, the families, to bring together. So I remember very much when I was a kid that I traveled in a Opel Capitan big car, and we had 10 kids in the back seat, and four mothers in front. We don't organize anymore our lives like that. Okay? But at the same time, we understand that we don't need to organize that because it's so easy to access to all these means of transport and mobility that you don't even realize that you have to organize something for that. You are just expecting that the things are there to use. And of course, that also means that you are much more so to define a kind of collective solution or a collective answer for your needs are much more complicated. It's much more a kind of combination of individual needs that can found something that is pre-organized by somebody. But it must not be just a huge company of transport. It could be just an that gives you in your hand all the alternatives that you can get. That's what you see. The other one is that, of course, the urbanization process, we are more and more urban. There are times when the United Nations said that in 2030, we are 60% of the population are living in urban spaces. That means that the settlement with more than 10,000 inhabitants is very, very large already. And then we are also put in question, and George shows you very, very clearly what is going on in the metropolitan area of Lisbon. That is the mixture of uses. That idea that was very revolutionary in the 20th century is that we have to separate industry for housing and shopping and more concentrated, etc. That the modern movement said, to respond to the problems of public health and the problems of pollution that exist in the previous towns. Well, today is no more the case. We don't have industry inside the cities, most of the cities, and even those who exist are not so polluted, they don't pollute so much like before. The complexity of our lives means that we have a lot of things together in your own neighborhood. But the heritage is very, very strong. we still have a lot of zoning in our cities by social classes, by activities, by facility to public transport or to private transport. These still going on. And these have been built for centuries. So we have to face this in another way. Well, some figures is interesting because we, as you know, we have a huge economic crisis between 2008, 2012, and it's still going on, right? The big crash was 2008, 2012. You can see that, in goods, it drops very much because the economic activity drops, but in terms of people, not so much. A little bit, it stabilized, the passenger cars stabilized a little bit. The air, yes, they have a crash because you move not so long compared to the money, but all the rest is more or less stable. And that's important because we are seeing that even with an economic crisis very strong hitting the center of Europe, even that people still moving on. The organization of their own lives is very good. But they move in very, very different ways. As you can see, the share of private cars in the model fleet is very, very different. In Hong Kong is about 10%. People can use it. Why? Well, because you cannot park your car in the center of Hong Kong. Or you are a very rich guy, or you cannot park. Even more, you cannot buy a car if you don't prove that you have a garage in your own house. So, and a lot of people could not afford that. So the share of public car use is very, very good. Madrid varies. Even New York, wow, New York people, yeah. It's equally expensive to park a car in New York. So if you are a very rich guy, these guys that you can see the movies and in the series of TV that lives nearby Central Park, yes, of course. These guys, some of them have cars, but not all. But all the great majority of them is they don't use cars. And so you can see it like New Yorkers, you know, that you have less than 40% of people are using cars. But for example, Lisbon is the time it was already over 40%. And if you look it for your daily life, it's now 62% of the time. Of course, if you go for Brazil and the States, that is kind of a spread of the urban development, the use of cars is more. It's almost the only way to move around, so to achieve. The consequences, everybody knows there. Although they put that in the movies, they put that in TVs, and so everybody knows. Understand, except Trump, that this is a problematic psychiatric problem, that you have climate changes going on. Climate change is not because you have different events, but they are stronger and they are more frequent, at least what is shown. But the good news is that they are not hitting anymore only the Asian Pacific countries, they are also hitting North America, and they are also hitting Europe, and that's going to be different, because when it hits Europe and the United States, people start seeking in another way. Well, we have to change our mobility for different reasons. One is energy alternatives. A guy that is a colleague of us and work with oil in the Gulbenkian Foundation company, as you know, Mr. Foundation is our Mr. Foundation. Mr. Carlos Gulbenkian was an Armenian that eats 5% of all the oil business in the Balkans at the time, so got a lot of money, as you can see, can imagine. And this foundation has until now a company for oil, and the CEO of this company is a colleague of us in our university, and The other day we were talking about Hawaii and about the future of Hawaii, and I said, well, I don't understand how can people imagine that we can live now without Hawaii. The stupidity is using Hawaii to move cars. Because this is the less efficient way to use Hawaii. But from medicines to all kind of materials, synthetic materials, you use oil. And that is a lot of plus value. You use oil for that because you cannot see until now any substitute for that. So the stupidity is to use oil to burn it in a car. So for him, the most important thing is to, for mobility, don't use oil. Try to use all kinds of energies, but not oil. Because we have to preserve oil for what is really needed and is really important. That is something that makes me think in a very different way. The other thing is not expansive, it's expensive. Is that the correction of automatic correction? Sometimes it never happens. We have to be more rational. Something that when we go to this kind of CBD in American towns and you see a huge amount of land just for parking cars, where the land is the most valuable. You see, but this is completely idiot. I pay a fortune to have a flat there, and in the same time, I use the land just to park a car during 8 hours, 25 square meters for nothing. It's really complicated. But that, so we have to be a more rational land use, and we have to have a more efficient use of the car, not only well, because of the time spent, it's a completely menace we have to do. When we call some guys that are traveling Friday night, I was in the seminar and in a neighborhood of that small town, 40 kilometers of the center of Lisbon. And people take, because they don't have public transport, the people take 1.5 hours to get a job to work, drive every day. 1.5 hours, 1.5 hours, 3 hours for that. That's great. So you have to find a different way. Well, can we act on that? Well, a few kind of ideas, rationality, attractiveness of public transport. The problem that to put all the means of transport very linked and easy to go. With a single car I can use, or a single application of my mobile phone I can use from a shared bike to a shared car, and all the means of public and collective transport is one way. The question of walkability not to be like that, but to be more like that. So we have to walk a little bit more every day. It's interesting. I just not can say just walk. You will see that to increase walk, you have to do a lot of work for walkability, to create the conditions for people to walk. And the three last ones I think is quite important. Information and communication, okay, it's going on more or less everywhere. The other one, integration land users for transport. People knew how to do that with highways and private cars, mobility, but they start now learning how to put in practice the theories of TOD, transport-oriented development, okay? In the books, everything is easy. But when you try to implement that, it's much more complicated, but it's very, very important to do that. And then the new technological devices. Okay, what is the user context and what is the question is for? As you can see in the last census, that is for the first time in Portugal, we have this situation, that private cars for what we call the obligatory, the compulsory travels, trips. For work and for study, for the first time, you have more people traveling by car than by other means of transport. Two-thirds by car, one-third by everything else. And, okay, bicycle starts, theory, that is quite important. Walking is increasing, but it's important as well to see that public transport is almost the same as the other one. So we have to change that. One of the reasons is that, I stop here because the theory is most important. When you look to the 70s in Europe and Portugal is one fourth of the motorization rate of Europe. Europe doubled in 20 years, and then in 10 years, it grows more than 50%. And look what happened in Portugal. And this is like Istanbul or big cities in Turkey, or if you go to the capitals of African countries, it's the same. In very short time, you move for a number that is under the European average to something that is bigger than the average. And the problem is not this itself. The problem is this grows so quickly. What that means? That means that the first generation of we have a car in the family is now. And I cannot tell to a young kid that just have a new toy that is a car. Okay, now we cannot use it. It's okay, in a dictatorship like China that says, okay, you only can buy a car if you the Communist Party authorizes you, and you have to prove that you have a garage. Okay, you can control it. If not, you can only control it if you got a kind of cultural development, like for example in Amsterdam, where people vote no more cars in historical centers because we had no space for them. And so they, by themselves in the democracy, they vote that you cannot buy new cars in Amsterdam center. You are not allowed, even if you are a resident. So every time that one resident leaves his car, it appears an opportunity to buy a place for one car, but only like that, no more. It is another side. So the problem is it's here, so we have to face it. The consequences, George and Toons have already told you, in red is what is the situation in the 90s, at the beginning of the 90s, and blue in the 10 years between the 90s and the end of the century, and it explodes. It's a kind of explosion. You see everything, the servers have exploded because this is the way that people buy the car, and you move from these 300 vehicles to 500 vehicles that explode in the area. And so we started creating something that it was very interesting. We bring always our students to see this neighborhood, to show them where, how in the 40s and 50s that we can design, even in the fascist regime, that we can design a good mixed use and social neighborhood, very interesting one, where everything is there, social facilities, a small industry area, etc., etc. And what is the monofunctional housing suburbs, where what we call with the force of the same ones, and these the picture of those parks specialized only office parks. So I go there in the morning, I work, I do everything there. I even have a cinema in that place, and then I go home. And the utopian, idealistic type of life for these UPs guys are. I go down my lift to my garage, I leave by the car, I enter the garage, I go by lift, I go by office. Fantastic. No more contacts with anybody. That's great. The other thing is what we are already talking about, and we are seeing the so-called Donuts effect. So the center is losing. It's no more the center, it's the already some first crown around the city, because the prices are very high, because tourists are taking the inflation of these, because the prestige of having an office in the big avenues in Lisbon is much more interesting than you have in the in an office park in the other side, etc., etc. So it goes. And the problem is that every day we have about 1 million cars that are going out in the city. The prices have dropped very much in terms of the use of the car. They are growing up again. And in Lisbon, that usually to say we don't even have half an orange. Half an orange is that, rather than 8 degrees. We have 137. Now, what is the problem? Well, the problem is that you cannot make a circle line. So, if you want to go from one place to another, you have to go straight on. If you are a city that is complete, you can make all ring roads everywhere. Everywhere in Europe, we have done that during the 60s and 70s, 80s. Ring roads to diverse traffic from the center. Well, in Lisbon you cannot do that because you have the estuary, like you have also here. So we have to cross. You have to bridge, you have to cross. The third bridge was thinking about that. But the big problem is that, as you can see, almost half of the cars come from that side. If you put some part of here, is more than half, and the jobs are here. So every day these guys are moving from that direction. So that was the problem. So what was the strategy that to face this? Typically, we have the same kind of strategies everywhere. So you have promoting the modality, so use everybody mode of transport to give a push to the more friendly modes of transport, and then to improve also traffic efficiency. Now, some deep environmentalists don't understand that if a car are in a congestion, it pollutes much more that is going in a good condition. So if you want to reduce emissions, you have to be also preoccupied about traffic conditions, not only with alternatives, but also with traffic. And then the land use and transport. So the idea is quite simple. This is a historical part, like Istanbul or so. This area, no cars, or less and less cars, much control. In the neighborhoods, you have the control. In the other areas, you have parking only for residents, and you pay much more, etc. Then you have a kind of extension of the city center where you put much more in favor of the articulation with public and cars, but especially to give priority to public transport and biking. And then we have a kind of a crown of articulation between the city and the periphery where the park and ride system should be implemented. So, okay, you have problems because the public transport system is not very good in the periphery. Okay, you can carry your car, but please, when you arrive nearby an underground station or a train station, leave your car and come to the city by car. It's much easier because the network is more. The second aspect is was very interesting. I think it's the first master plan in Portugal that does that. Around the underground stations and the main train stations or interfaces, you can have a supplement of floor area. So, for example, you can build 1.5 square meters per square meter of land. But if you build here. Jobs, you can have 2 square meters per square meter of land. In one condition, no car facility. So there is no car parks. You have to only a few ones for the CEOs and these guys. Okay, they have the right, but you cannot offer more than X car park facilities together. If you do that, you can have a supplement of strength. That is very interesting. Because one place of car is 25 square meters in a structure. So if I can get half a square meter in class, and I reduce 25 square meters, it means that I have 12.5 square meters to sell. And to sell, as Antun tells you, to sell at 4,000 euros per square meter. It's a lot of money. So people began to be interested. So you put the areas where you have to, will concentrate the jobs in the areas you can go more easily by public transport, and where the offer of private cars is less. So how can we do that in practice? Well, the first thing is always is the carrot and the stick. In policy, when we are dealing with social sciences, people have habits, preconceptions, ideologies, and unfortunately, which is my opinion, they are not so rational like engineers. And they are not so gods like architects. So it's very good. It's good to have these kind of things that you cannot control. But you can influence. And how can you influence our habits? Well, to create alternatives in one way, to make the people experiment the alternatives. For example, the other day when you want to come in, etc., and we are with Kester in Balat, but we are a little bit tired and to prepare the things, and so I said, okay, we go home earlier, and Kester, that is a very nice and rich person, gave us a small car for the transport, and we use the car to use the public transport, and with the same car, the three guys, I put three times the guard, and with the three guys enter the public transport. That is not possible in Lisbon. The guard is only for one person. Stupid, completely stupid. The only rationale is that the job card pulls half an euro. And so the company, the public company, wants to pay, that you have to pay half an euro. That's stupid, because the first important thing is that with that card that Kessler gives us, you just enter the system. So you experience the system. And after to have a good experience of the system, you start to use it. So that is the big thing. So you have to do this kind of stick and carrot. Well, what is the stick? Well, you pay. If you want to park, you pay. We change that. In Lisbon, you could park in the center of Lisbon, the center, hyper center of Lisbon, or in the periphery, you pay the same. Okay, you change that. You say, well, in the center area, you pay 50% more than the periphery. And if you are in an area where the public transport is very high, you pay twice, and you can only park for 2 hours. So you pay two times more, and you park two hours less. Secondly, we introduce what is the emissions control. So little by little, the first time it was just I understand that. I think that every person that give lectures in universities should be in one elected post job, and work also in one firm, not one office. Very important to understand the big difference between what is the politically correct and that we put in the books. What we think that is the good solution, what we think that is the solution that we can convince all of our colleagues in the council, then the people, and then that we can implement it. And from A to Z, if you get 20%, is very good. Of course, the logo was saying always that our profession as urban planners, we should be very psychological, because the number of failures are so big that when we get some victory, it's very fantastic. So we have to enjoy it very much, and we have to be robust to work it all the way. So the first time, this was something just to put in the front page of the newspaper. We say, well, in this zone, Cars before 92 or 90 cannot go, except if you are a resident, if you are a taxi driver, public transport, if you have a lorry, etc., etc., etc. So all the exceptions, you just, this first time, you say, touch 5% of the traffic, nothing. The consequences in the emissions, zero. What is the difference? Starting from doing nothing to doing something. So you make the first step, very small one, but you start moving. So in the other day, we enlarge this zone every year. And then we squeeze and put more difficulty in that area. So that's good. Secondly, people should understand that in residential areas or in the concentration of jobs areas, you have the car. Okay, you can go the car. In some residential, you can go. But the car is only one of the person that use the public space. It's not the user of the public space. It's one of. So we introduce a new conception with some electric, etc. 30 kilometer zone, so that means that you can play in the street, etc. You have you create schemes that people that want to make a bypass before inside the neighborhood, now they cannot do that. It's just simple to that. You put a sign here and cannot enter. So today, the people get away, so they don't have to cross anymore. Small things like that, but that counts down a lot the inside of the area. Then, that is the sticks. Now we are moving to the carrot. So you introduce in the big interfaces, that is the last one, we have quite confused at the time. Look at the, this gray is where cars can go. Now is the new one, so that is the final work. So the trees are still very, very small, but with the computers you can imagine how can we be in the end. So it's much well organized. This area is only for public transport. People can cross in very directions, so you don't have these people that should cross just there. So because it's much calm, so it's very interesting. You put the waterfront in the area, you create there. Another aspect, we've told you that integrates in terms of the ticket, the same ticket for using the car and using public transport. You can come by car, then you stop, and you now it's 51 euros, and for 51 euros you can park every day in the car park, control park car, with the supervision, etc. And you can use all the network of public transport in this during this week, this time. Well, at the time we defend much cheaper than that, but the bus companies don't reduce the car parks, reducing 50% the rent, the monthly payment is 50% for the combined system, but the public transport, they just only reduce 10 or 15%, so it is quite expensive, so it was not very successful. And then to pay attention to the elderly people, that is interesting that Transport for London, they will make a kind of a calculation that the people that were born into between the 40s and 50s lives until 90 years old at maximum, but the people that are born already in the new century could live more than 100 years. What means two things. First, they have much more years to enjoy the end of life without working, but working in small things, not so compulsory. But they have much more difficulties because our body is a structure. We can calculate it like a structure of a building. With the big difference. Our bones have fatigue. And our nerves and everything else have fatigue. So you have a structure that to make the structure move, you have all of the electronics and things to chemical and physical to, and that comes fatigue. Even if your brain is very good, you have some difficulties. So you have to think about these kind of persons. And most of them don't use iPhones. So you have to think about it. Well, in this one we have made a very interesting experience because the public company after trying retired lines in the old town because it was not rental, so they were not profitable, so they just cut it. 25% of the lines were cut it in this one at the time of the crisis. So the municipality has to respond to that, especially in these old neighborhoods where the people are old, etc. And so they introduced this kind of service, a free service, with a small bus and a circuit that goes from the main aspects where people need, the market, the health center, the administrative service, etc. And so they could do that. It's one solution, it's not the only one solution. Then to promote eco-friendly mobility, that is to Azru, that is in that area, especially for her. So our colleagues have developed a new kind of index parameter that connects all these things, the connectivity, convenience, comfort, user friendliness, the existing equipment. So the continuity, the diversity of land use, because some of people when they are designing the urban space, they don't think, they just think on that. Continuity, quality of pavements, etc. And don't think about the other aspect that makes that area, that new bus is used. Why? Because it's a traffic. Because it's safe. Because we have reference points. If you don't know some place, you have to know, well, you go there for St. Stephen's Church, and then you drop it, and then you can walk in the next to the right. Okay, I know. I can, if you don't have these reference points, you can make all what you want for a food pass nobody uses. And for safety, etc., etc. What the study that have been done in Lisbon with more than, I think it's about 2,000 people, surveys, observation, etc., is that there are a very high correlation between the number of people walking in that section of the streets and the diversity index, the walkability index that our colleagues have developed. And that is very important, that they have these kind of things. So with these on mind, we have developed what we call the pedestrian mobility plan for Lisbon. So how can we improve walkability in Lisbon? So this is from the access to buildings, to public transport, to cross the streets, etc., to introduce special pavements in the traditional calçada in Portugal, because the calçada we make a survey with old people, and I think it was about 70% of them have already fall down in the calçada, so you have to create some kind of that to define the kind of metrics for design for crossing accessible for everybody, and so we define what is the pavements and colors, etc. And of course, we introduce some differences in India. I don't like the solution. The project where I've worked, we have put the trees in this area that we make all the center just for cars, because this is useful. It's only for us to be beautiful. If you put it here, it's different because you have the cycle line, so you have a cycle line in the shadow and more protected, but okay. What was important is that you introduce some new kind of human presence in the area. This, for example, is one of the big square of traffic in Lisbon, and it was completely transformed, as you can see. We use this together, we don't put the cars nearby the buildings, it's much more green, etc., and it's much more pleasant in here. In another aspect, because we are an illy city like you, Istanbul, what we have done is that a lot of structures with old trams that have been rehabilitated in terms of lines and to wheelchairs in stairs in the underground system, so you can move from one point to another point that is about 30-40 meters high without effort. We introduce public lifts in the buildings, existing buildings, so you can cross from one side to another side of the valley of the downtown in very, very, very easy way. And the other aspect is that the studies that are showing us that one car sharing car replaced up to 12. That is in Germany, the studies that are being doing there, they are much more developed than we are now. But with the electric powered cars, that is very easy to go because it's very friendly and is very less costly. So you can put a car sharing in a very cheap way. Because with the other ones, it was expensive, the energy. So that is very interesting. You have a kind of first time to start, but then it goes up very well, so we have to do that. I have to finish it, and it was my last slide, because I love that very much. You have also to give signs, political signs, to convince people that you are gaining something. Of course, it's very useful if you can park your car here in the center of the town and work here in the Ministry of Finance, the most powerful minister in every government in the world. He's always the guy of finance, the guy that says that he can spend our money. So here, oh, it's fantastic, lovely. But, okay, we will cut that thing out and we transform it in a very large pedestrian square. And the first time the people react, because we cut the traffic here and there, etc., we reduce this part was five lanes before, now it's two lanes. So it's very short, different pavement. Okay, but people enjoy it very much. And they began to understand, okay, it's good in holidays, we cut the traffic so people can even walk over there. Of course, the tourists that are not used to this good weather, 33 degrees, and the water is supposed to be in this, but they even use that there are these sun baths and things like that. But the important thing is that this was made in one mandate, 4 years of government in the municipality. So this is also important. If you make a kind of project like that, you have to be sure that in the decision you take and when you finish, you should be in the same mandate. Because if that was not completed before the elections, you risk to lose the elections. Because you only have suffered all the consequences of the work of having bad cars and etc. And you don't see with your own eyes what is the benefit. So that is very important, how you schedule that. So in the first mandate we have make that, then in the second mandate we have to do that, in the third one we have to make the but don't forget we have to make missing links. That was how Lisbon was in terms of traffic. So this waterfront line was very, very important one. The first thing we learned is getting. So you get that you can cross, but it's very difficult. And then we said, well, you have to make more in this kind of grid to avoid traffic. In the second term, we reduce the importance of this other network. And so with these two ones, it's preferable to go into the side. It don't work so well because before us, the mayor has developed a tunnel here, and so and the tunnel is connected to the highway, where it comes more cars for Lisbon every day. So of course people still going on in that direction. But complete the road network with a different perspective. This is a project that has been made by traffic engineers, architects, urban planners, and landscape architects. We sit together in the same table and we design it. And so this is no more, this is one of the most important entrances by cars in the city. So it don't look like anymore. You have a square, it's no more a road, just like that.
can see the highway here, a square, you have a different perception. You skip one of the lanes to improve pedestrian footpaths, explains, and things like that. So, conclusion, because I'm exceeding my time, it's possible to have a change. These figures have been presented by Transport for London in last year, and I have not even put it in a very good shape, but okay. Between 2000 and 2015, so we have an increase by 1/3 in the train by 70% in the underground, 70% in the bus, 125% in bike sharing, and we have reduced cars in 60%, small volumes in 60%. So you make a big change in traffic model split, and that is important. So it's possible even in a healthy country, even in the financial capital of Europe. To do that, what you have to do, what you need for it. Well, the first one is to have a vision for the future. So you have to act in a four years mandate, but we have to think in the long, long term. And that vision, you have to share it with your population, with the people that elect you. Because you can have a very good vision, but if nobody follows you, you will be crossed like Christ. So it will be very interesting for religious purposes, but not for social problems of the people. So that is very important. The second one, please don't be geological against any mode of transport. Every mode of transport is useful. For example, if you go to a beach with your family, two kids, three kids, and two adults in the car, is cheaper, is more ecological than to go in the bus with only 10 people inside. So for some times you have to separate what is rational, what is scientifically proved, and what is just geology. So it's important to do that. Secondly, if you have, of course, we have to reduce the pressure of the cars, because this is the mainstream now. So you have to reduce it. But to reduce that, you have to act simultaneously in parking policies, traffic control access, but at the same time, all the alternatives must be clear, attractive, safety, and easy to go. And of course, that means that you have to improve what we can call eco-mobility. But for that, think about networks. It's no use to make a very good 200 meters waterfront that you don't go to anywhere and you don't care for anywhere. You have to be linked to something. Even if you build it by phases, of course. But we have to understand that part of the waterfront of Lisbon in the big square is part of a promenade that have in the end something like 20 kilometers. Okay? That's the idea. And finally, go more and more for sharing schemes. And fortunately, your generation is much more easygoing than ours. Most of the young generation in more central European countries understand already that it's a stupidity to have a car every day because it costs very much, you have a lot of troubles, and it's preferable to have a shared car or to loan a car for the weekend or for the holiday. So if you are with a girl or a boyfriend that you want to impress, you have a comfortable in the weekend. But if you want to go with a lot of friends, you have a van. If you want to make a long distance trip, you have a roadster, etc. And you don't have to be rich to have all these different kinds of cars. So that's the idea. Share more the transport that will be useful for everyone. And with the technology, that becomes much easier, of course. A lot of things become much easier like that. And of course, integrate planning, urban planning, transport planning, and mobility, because they are very, very much